Jezreel's son. Listen to this verse. Just listen to these words. This, to me, this is one of the most anointed hymns that has ever been written. As far as the verbiage in the language in this song, it says, could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above, would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Bless our brother as he brings us the word tonight. Open our ears that we might hear it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Come, Brother Ron, and teach us the word. Brother Ron is a teacher. He has the anointing of a teacher. And we need to pray that we have the anointing of the learner. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. Thank you, everybody, for coming out tonight. Praise God. Seems like it's been forever since we've been together. I think it's been about 5 or 6 weeks. So I'm sure you have forgotten everything I told you 5 or 6 weeks ago.
No, we did not.
Of course, your memory may be slightly better than mine. So, you know, you may be able to endure long and remember much. I don't know. We'll see. Praise the Lord. Let's see where I want to put this. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, we thank you tonight for the ingrafted word that allows us to grow and mature and become all that you've called us to be. For we truly are kings and priests in training unto God. We're trained to be leaders in the new kingdom. When he comes to establish his kingdom here on the earth, we will be leaders in that kingdom. So we need to prepare ourselves now. Thank you, Lord, for preparing us through the Word and by your Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for opening up the Word and teaching us the revelation, knowledge, and wisdom of God. We receive it tonight, Lord, and we thank you for it. Thank you for anointing this your servant to proclaim that which needs to be proclaimed and to forget that which needs to be forgotten. And I give you praise for that in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Good, Lord.
Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. The importance of God's love. That's what we've been talking about. And we'll end that tonight. But we'll pick it up again some other time.
Brother Ron, I was going to ask you if you could go ahead and teach next Sunday night.
On that again?
Yeah. Can you finish it?
We'll see. Yeah, I can definitely teach next Sunday night, not a problem.
Hi!
We'll see how far we get in this tonight because it'll be a refresher. It's so funny. I was listening to Joyce Meyer one evening late. I listened to some televangelist, not me. She has gotten better over the years as she's gotten older and more mature, and she's learned a few things, as we all do if we press in. But she said an interesting thing. You know, she's written a lot of books. And she said there was one book she wrote. And she said, all, most of her books sell fairly well. but this book didn't even pay for the print.
Oh my. Oh.
So she didn't know what it was. She says, I can't understand why that it didn't sell. Because it was the most important topic that I'd ever written about. And can you guess what it was?
Love.
She said, I wrote on love and how to die to self and be selfless. And she said, nobody wanted to read that.
Amen.
So lately she said, I've gotten smart, so I trick people by putting a different title on the front.
Amen.
And that way when they get in the book, they get it whether they wanted it or not. So, you know, however that works. But it's interesting to notice that people will buy books by the hundreds for faith or about the Holy Spirit or about any of the main things, the joy of the Lord and all of that. They'll buy the books to, or how can I prosper? Yeah, and have everything that God promised me. They'll buy the books for that. But when it comes to the foundational principle, they think, oh, well, love, I've heard love, you know, and you know how that is. And, you know, we have cheapened the word love by using it to, you know, I love pizza. I love going to the ball game, you know. You use that more than you say like. If you think about it, you use love more than you say like. But what we're really saying is I like that. Not that we love it.
Mm-hmm.
I had a little blue Mustang when I was a young man, and I really liked that car. And I guess, you know, I could have said I loved it, and maybe I did back then, Lord knows, because I sure took care of it well enough. But my wife said I took care of it better than I did her, and that, you know, that might have been true, I'm not sure. But anyway, that thing couldn't love me back. It was just a piece of metal. No matter how pretty and polished and everything I did with it, you know, polished it up and talked to it, it didn't seem to respond at all. So see, we've got misconceptions of what love is all about. The British people, the English people, over in England, over in Great Britain, they use the word love. Well, how you doing today, love? Right? They place it in the place of dear or some other endearing term, right? They'll say love. And so see how we have used that and used that word. So now when we talk about love, everybody thinks, oh, you know, I just don't want to go there. I don't see the importance of that. Yes, we got to have it, but, you know, what's that going to get me? See, we're so selfish. What's that going to get me? Well, love is not about getting.
That's right.
For you.
Amen.
And if you go at it that way, you're going to miss the whole point. But anyway, I just wanted to preface that because we have cheapened love to the point where using that word anymore doesn't mean anything to anybody or to most folks. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, if you'll turn there with me. We're going to do a review tonight because it's been so many weeks since we've been together. We're going to have to review some things.
Jesus.
1 Thessalonians chapter 4. As we talk about the importance of God's love. Now, all of us want strong faith because we know faith can move mountains and faith can overcome enemies and faith can take care of sickness and disease and faith can do a lot for us, right?
Right.
You know, but the Bible says in Galatians 5 and 6, I think it is, faith works by love. So in order to have strong faith, you must have strong love. If you don't have strong love, you can't possess strong faith.
That's right.
Faith, as I said before the other time we were together, faith gives substance to hope. But love gives substance to faith. It's the foundational principle which everything else comes off of.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what you're doing, if you're not doing it out of love, then you're missing what God intended for you, how He wanted you to operate in whatever gift it is, no matter what it is. If you don't operate out of the gift of love when you're, you know, like in prophecy or any other thing, and we'll look at that a little later, then you're not doing anything for the kingdom of God. You're not going to avail. Your words are going to fall to the ground. They're not going to accomplish.
Funking symbols.
But you might impress people.
Yeah.
You know, if you're slick and smooth and just call them slick willies, You know, if you're a slick willy and you can turn a phrase, and there's some folks on the televangelist, you know, on television that are slick now. I mean, they can turn a phrase and they know how to talk. And they know how to present themselves and get endear people to them. And unfortunately, a lot of times it's for the wrong reasons. And eventually, you know, it's for money or for something else. They're after your money or after something. They're not just there to bless you. Now, that's not everybody on TV, but that's too many of them are like that. And so you need to be wary who you listen to on TV. Make sure that the people that are you're listening to have the motivation of love, of wanting to serve, rather than wanting you to serve them.
That's right. That's right.
You see, because that'll be a dangerous thing if you get into that. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 9. But as touching brotherly love, you need not that I write unto you, for you yourselves are taught of God to love one another. So we're taught by who?
God
to love. So the only true love is the love that's taught by God, right? Anything else is not God's love. He teaches us. The Bible says that the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. So it's not that we have to go looking for love. We need to learn how to release love.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Because it says it's been shed abroad in our hearts. So we're full of love, right?
Right.
Our spirit man is full of love, right?
Right.
But some people you meet, you'd swear they don't have any, you know. But every born-again believer, according to the Word of God, the love of God has been shed abroad. That's one of the gifts you receive, and the main gift, really, has been shed abroad in your hearts by the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not a matter of finding it, or attaining to it, or working toward it.
Mm-hmm.
It's a matter of releasing it.
Yes.
And showing that you have that love inside of you. And love is a decision, it's not feelings. You see, so much of the time we're waiting for a feeling. Well, if you love me, I'll love you. But if you don't love me, then I'm certainly not going to love you. You know, and husbands and wives get into that relationship where, hey, if you do certain things for me, then I'll love you. And if I do certain things for you, you should love me. So the marriage is based upon what the other person does for you.
Come on, talk now.
See, instead of a mutual love and respect for one another grounded in the Word of God, a love that never fails, a love that is not selfish, but selfless, who puts the other person first. You see, if both partners put each other first,
that's
everybody's
right.
going to be happy.
That's it.
Right.
Amen.
Now, if you're putting the other partner first and they're not doing it to you, well, then that's not a good situation.
No.
But even if they are not reciprocating, if you're a born-again believer, you're duty-bound to love them with the love of God. And trust and pray that somehow God will bonk them on the head and get them to start loving you back like you love them.
Yes.
Amen.
But God's love will never disappoint.
Amen.
Praise God. Verse 10, and indeed you do it toward all the brethren which are in Macedonia, but I beseech you, brethren, that you increase more and more. So can we increase in our output of love to each other?
Yes, yes.
We can we? The Bible says that right there. Paul prayed that they would increase more and more. In other words, learn how to release more. He says you're doing a good job. And all of you here tonight are probably doing that on some level or you wouldn't be here. You're doing a good job, but I want you to get better at it. I want you to be more perfect in sharing your love with each other. Because the Bible says love covers a multitude of sins, and that doesn't mean in your life, that means in the life of those around you. Because we've all got imperfections, and love never judges the other person. It believes the best of the other person.
That's what it says.
Yeah. See? But we're so quick in the church world now to judge and be critical and judgmental. Well, we're not walking in love when we do that, are we?
No.
And that doesn't help anybody when you're critical and judgmental, because now you've taken on the robes of God and you say that you are God and you're going to say that this person needs to do this. Have you noticed that people always have advice for you but they don't ever take their own advice.
Yeah.
Mm.
But they can fix your problem or tell you what your problem is real quick. But you know they've got problems too, but they can't seem to get the idea that they need to take their own advice. They think, well, I'm a hopeless case, so I'm going to see if I can help you. Maybe that's the way they're looking at it. I'm not real sure. They already have given up on themselves. They think, well, maybe I can help this other person be a better person than I am. You know, maybe that's the way they're thinking. I'm not real sure. But love is something that always prefers the other person over yourself. And if you learn to walk in that love, you learn to release the love of God like that, it'll change your life. It'll change the ability of faith, because faith only works through love, is only strong when your love is strong. There's a lot of people who say, I don't understand why my prayers don't get answered, or why I'm not strong enough in faith, or why the devil comes in and attacks me here. I don't understand. Well, it's probably your love walk that is suffering, and because that is suffering, your faith is suffering. You see, a lot of times we don't identify that if our love is not flowing out like it should, then it affects every other gift of the Spirit.
Yes, it does.
Everything that God does for us. It affects every area. And so love is important, is it not?
Amen.
Learning how to release that love will change your life and get people around you to think you're not such a bad guy after all. Amen. You know, because if you're espousing the love of God, you're automatically going to be wanting to help other people and not seeing what you can get out of other people, but rather seeing what you can pull into other people. How you can help other people rather than trying to get them to help you all the time. You know, there's takers or users, and then there's those that are givers. Have you met them? Have you know those folks? You know, and nobody likes to be around a user or somebody that takes all the time. You know, if you come into church, if you're born again, you should not be a user. You shouldn't use people for your own benefit, or you shouldn't just have your hand out all the time.
Amen.
You should be willing. Yeah, it's all right to receive, but you need to give as well.
Amen.
And you say, well, I don't have money. Well, we're not just talking about money. There's things you can do in the church. You know, you can help. There's always a list in the bulletin of things that need to be done, that places that need to be filled, offices that need to be taken care of. So there's all kinds of things you do besides putting money in the plate. Every time people think about giving, they automatically go to finances. And God, you know, that's not where God is. There's a multitude of ways you can give into the church and be a part of the church. And when you become a part of something, then you feel like you belong and you feel like you have an anchor. And the church is where we come together and encourage one another.
Amen.
Build one another up. Share our love with one another. When you're down, I share my love with you. I encourage you. I lift you up. That's what we do as a church.
Yes.
And if we're not doing that, we're missing the boat.
Be a servant.
We're letting the devil steal our love and steal our camaraderie that we have as born-again believers together.
Amen, Brother Ron. Hallelujah. Let us increase, Lord.
Verse 11, and that you study to be quiet. Some people need to underline that.
Amen.
That you study to be quiet. Some people say, I'm too quiet. I'm just following the scripture, that's all. That you study to be quiet and to do your own business. Wouldn't that be novel? If everybody mind their own business instead of trying to mind your business.
Amen.
You know? Now, if I go to you and want to counsel, that's one thing. But if you just come around and say, let me tell you what you need to do. You're minding my business now, and I haven't asked for that. And most of the time, those people don't like that either, you know. So, you know, that's something you don't need to do. The Bible says, mind your own business. Paul was saying to the church in Macedonia, you be quiet. Be a quiet, confident, sober person. Mind your own business. Do your own work. Don't bother anybody else. If they ask for help, you help them. But don't get into other people's affairs. Don't be a busybody.
Amen.
Don't be nosy. I've got people that come to me and they'll ask me questions. I thought, why do they want to know that? What good will that do them if I tell them that? Will they use it against me later? You know, I mean, you don't know what people ask.
Right,
but some of them are
right.
strange questions, you know. They'll ask strange things. And you think, yeah, they're asking that for some kind of weird reason. And I better not answer because I'll probably regret it later down the line. You ever felt like that?
Oh, yes.
We need to cast out the spirit of busybodiness, right?
Amen.
Amen.
Come out.
And that you study to be quiet and to do your own business and to work with your own hands as we have commanded you. And see, now we go into some things that you walk, you may walk honestly toward them that are without. So what is the purpose of growing in love and increasing in love, as he said earlier, is so that we can show the world, that's the people without, that we can show the world that God is something powerful, that his love is working in us, and that it changed us from what we used to be to what we are becoming and what we are now, and we're growing in the grace and love of God and becoming more conformed to him in his image and his likeness, and so that when they look at us eventually, somewhere down the line, if we live long enough, they'll see Jesus instead of you. Smith Wigglesworth got to the place where he was so full of the power and the Spirit of God and the love of God that people were convicted just by being in his presence.
Yeah.
Or if they were sick, you know, they would just feel that they needed to share their problem with him because somehow they knew that he had the answer. And he always did. Because he had a special relationship with God. A special relationship with Jesus. You need that special relationship. And love is where we find that special relationship. You won't find it in anything else. You can go chasing after gifts, but you need to be what God is. What is God?
Love.
God is love. We need to be love.
Amen.
You see, a lot of these other things, and a lot of the problems that we have, and we all have shortcomings or weaknesses, you will find that if your love increases, those things just normally go away.
That's right.
Your selfishness, you don't have that anymore. You're selfless. You think about other people. You prefer other people. Love will change your total thinking and how you act toward other folk. And that's what God wants with our lives. That you might walk honestly toward them that are without, and that you may have lack of how much?
Nothing.
That's a pretty big promise, right?
Amen.
Are you lacking?
No.
I'm lacking. I'm lacking in certain areas. Aren't you lacking in certain areas? Has somebody got it all together? Raise your hand. I want to talk to you after the service. Bless God. I want to find out your secret. We're all lacking in some areas, aren't we? Well, see, as we grow in love, that decreases. The lack decreases till we can get to the point, the Word says, where we lack for
nothing.
Wouldn't that be a neat place to be? Where we never had to worry about anything about us because we knew God's taking care of us. What's that scripture saying that we quote but we don't ever follow? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness.
Yeah.
And all of those things will be added unto you, right? Now we quote that scripture and we know it, but we don't believe it. Because if we did, it'd change our lives. I mean, you know, there's a lot of folks that know a lot of scriptures, but they don't believe a tenth of them. Just because you have scriptures in your mind doesn't mean that you're going to be able to live by those scriptures. You have to put those scriptures into practice. They have to become revelation to you to where you walk out the revelation that God has given you. And love is the way we learn to do all of that.
Yes, it is. Amen.
Praise God. Well, are we getting anything out of this tonight?
Yes, yes.
Praise God.
Teaching us to live. Amen.
Praise the Lord. I forgot where I'm going, so let me find my little thing here.
3:12, 1 Thessalonians.
And let me see where I want to go from there. That's right. I think that's the next one, isn't it? See, I've got notes that are different from where I decided I was going to go tonight. Changing it at the last minute. Isn't that fun?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it's fun. Praise God. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, just go back one chapter, 1 Thessalonians, not easy to say fast three times, 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 verse 12, so we're right there close, talking about the importance of God's love, Brother Ken and I were talking the other day. And this has nothing really to do with what we're talking about, but it's just an interesting thought. The Holy Spirit revealed something to me. We were talking about Brother Hagin Sr. and how some people had accused him of plagiarism. You know what plagiarism is? Using other people's material as your own. And I was praying about that, and really not praying exactly about that, but just meditating. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, nobody owns the truth. But me.
Amen.
Nobody owns the truth, so nobody can say you plagiarized from me, because where did they get it? They didn't originate it. So how can they say it's plagiarism? See, that in the world it could be plagiarism, but in the things of the kingdom of God, hey, it's all the Spirit of truth. He is the author of all truth. We didn't author anything. We didn't originate anything. So how can we accuse one brother or another being plagiaristic? It's foolishness. You know, it's wrong, and it's wrong thinking. Amen. He had a great ministry, Brother Hagin Sr., and I learned a lot from him. And I don't really care where he got it from.
That's right.
To be honest with you, because you say, well, he got it from E.W. Kenyon. Well, where did E.W. Kenyon get it from?
That's right.
Guarantee you, it didn't originate with him. He got it from somebody maybe 100 years before that he read a book on. John G. Lake, do you think he originated all those? No, he didn't. Smith Wigglesworth? No, even though he might originate more than we think. But mainly he was known for his ability to get people healed. His tremendous healing anointing. So see, we need to stop judging people in the church like people judge people in the world. You understand what I'm saying? See, we tend to let the judgment of the world creep into the church. And so we judge each other by the standards of the world, which is totally wrong, because God has a different standard. It says His ways and thoughts are
higher
than the world's, by a long ways. So let's don't get in those traps.
Amen.
Bible says, judge not lest you be
judged.
I don't know about you, on the best day that God, when He's having a really good day, I don't want Him judging me. I mean, when He went to the lake and caught a bunch of fish, I still won't want Him judging me that day. You know? No. Bible says, judge yourself. Judge yourself. If you judge yourself, hey, you won't need to be judged. So I just learn to judge myself as much as I can. And that can be a full-time job. Amen?
Yes.
Just taking care of your own business can be a full-time job, can't it? Taking care of you can be a full-time job. We are so quick to want to help other people see their faults. But we ain't doing nothing with ours. That's the wrong approach to things, isn't it?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
I forgot to pick up the mic. I don't know if it got any of that on the tape or not.
Yeah, it comes through all right.
I'm so loud it probably came through anyway. All right. Let's see, we're in 1 Thessalonians. We're in chapter 3, are we?
3:12.
Yeah, I don't have that in my notes, and it just kind of throws me off. 3:12. And the Lord make you to increase and abound in what?
Love.
So we're to what? We're to increase and we're to abound in love one toward another. So I got to love you. Again, love is not a feeling. Some people gravitate to other people because they're of like personalities. You know? And so they just gravitate to those people. And they like them, and that people like them back. And so it's just a circle of like and love and wonderfulness. But then if you try to get into their little group, oh, well, we can't be having that. Who are you? Somebody new comes into the church and doesn't feel like they're being accepted, and we're not trying to reach out and bring them into our group? Well, what are we doing? We're being hypocritical, aren't we?
That's right.
We don't know them. We don't know whether we love them or not. But God says we're to love all of the church people, right?
Amen.
We're to love everybody at all times. So don't sit there and say, well, I'm going to look them over and I don't know if I love them or not. You know, I don't particularly like the way they dress, you know, that, and their hair, oh my. You know, and that makeup, oh mercy. Yeah, so, you know, then you're automatically, what, being critical and judgmental. You're already putting them in the box, you know, and saying, no, that's not my kind of person. No, that's the wrong way to approach it, right? When new people come into the church, reach out to them and include them in your circle. You know what we should be doing, those of us that are more mature? When you see new couples or new people coming into the church, once they've been here a few times, you should go around. Of course, you automatically should shake their hand, tell them they're glad they're here. That goes without saying, right? But then eventually you should say, hey, why don't we go to lunch after church? Take them somewhere and spend some time with them, and you'll find out that they're pretty good people if you just spend some time. Some people don't like me because they think I'm arrogant and uppity and all of this and that. You know? Well, they don't know me.
That's right.
You know, they don't know me, but they've judged me already. They've already judged me without knowing me. They haven't went to dinner with me once. They haven't sat down and had a conversation with me the first time, but they know who I am.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
You know. Well, that's not the love of God, is it?
No.
In operation? See, we're seeing the things that we're short in that the love of God will make up in our lives.
Amen.
If you just walk in the love of God, it'll change the way you look at people, Christians and other folk.
Amen.
It'll change the way you deal, have your dealings with other people. You know, and this is important because if we can't love each other in the group, how in the world are we going to love the world?
Come on.
Right.
We're just not going to get there, are we?
Come on, no. Brother.
If we can't show love within the body, we're just not going to make it. The world is just going to go to hell in a handbasket, as they say. And it'll be our fault. Praise God.
Help, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you see a poor, lonely preacher who, you know, that's lonely and looks lonely, you need to take him to lunch. If you don't know who that is, I'll draw you a picture. Amen, amen. Praise God. Well, we won't go there. All right. Thank you, Jesus. Let's read on. Increase and abound in love one to another and toward all men, even as we do toward you, to the end he may establish your heart. Look at this. This love, if you're doing this, he will establish, God will establish your hearts unblameable in holiness. You want to be holy?
Yes.
Bible says, be holy as I am holy, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is a way to get to holiness. Love will bring you to what?
Holiness.
Holiness. See how many things love, if you're learning to walk in love, how many things that will open up for you,
yeah,
that you want to get to, that you desire to get there, but you don't know how to get there. You don't see the path. It's not clear. Love will lead you into the paths of holiness.
Amen.
Because if you perfect love, hey, holiness will be there.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Well, there's a few more folk that need to hear that are not here tonight, right?
Right.
Amen.
Yes. Bless their darling hearts. And I'll leave the rest of the know how it goes. So, praise the Lord.
Can't finish it.
To the end that he may establish your hearts unblameable,
yes,
in holiness before God, even as our Father, at the coming of the Lord Jesus with all his saints. Praise God. That's a great verse. Thank you, Jesus. Where do we go next? We're just running through. I'm teaching tonight. So
next verse, Brother Ron.
15, John 15, right? The Gospel of John, chapter 15. But we're talking about the importance of love. I probably need to look at my watch. Oh, my gosh. Time flies when you're having fun.
Let's see. Amen.
John 15. Well, we can definitely do something next week, brother.
Yeah.
I haven't got very far.
That's good. Let's do it. Let's work some more on it next week.
But we got some people show up. Can everybody here invite one person to come next Sunday night and say, hey, it's good. I know you don't think love's important, but you need to come and hear this because
yes,
you need it.
Yes, we do.
I don't know if you want to say that or not, but you can work that out between you and them.
I need
it. Praise God. But you can say something like, I really believe that it'll be a major benefit to you.
Well, save you a lot of trouble.
Amen. Amen. Save you a lot of heartache, won't it? Praise God. John 15. Oh, here's mine. Verse 9. Now, we've looked at this before, and I'm not going to look at all of it, but because we've already looked at it once. But I am going to look at a couple of things. Notice it says in verse 9, as the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue you in my love. So once, even though you have the love of God shed abroad in your heart by the Holy Spirit, you have that love. What's he telling you to do there? Continue in the love. How do I continue in the love? You share it. You become more proficient in sharing your love. That's continuing in the love. It's not enough to say, yes, I've got the love of God in me. And I say, well, you sure don't act like it. Bless God. You're an ornery person. You know, you're mean all the time. And you never smile. And you're telling me the love of God is in you. Hey, you know, man, we need to pull back the curtain. Bless God. Let some of that light out, because it's being hidden right now. You know, we need to let our light shine, as the Bible says.
Hallelujah.
Continue in my love. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love. So how do we stay in the love of God and have the love of God continue in our life? We keep his commandments, his word, right? It's important. You see, the love of God is conditional as far as it's concerned about how you share it with other people. There is a condition to that. You must do what? You must keep the commandments of God. And I know we don't like to have commandments or laws or rules laid out. But when Jesus said, a new commandment I give unto you, he was saying, hey, I got a new order for you.
That's right.
He didn't say, hey, if you feel like doing this on a good day, you know, you might want to try this. No, he said, it's a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. And then he goes on to say, by this shall all men, how many?
All
men know that you are my disciples. You don't have to put the sticker on your bumper of your car, you see, or do anything else. They'll know because of your love, right? Because you have been walking in using your love and become perfected in your love, they'll know who you are. You won't have to flash across the front end in highlights. Thank you, Jesus. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you. How many want God's joy remaining in you all the time? Because the joy of the Lord is our
strength.
So if you got God's joy remaining in you all the time, you got what?
Strength.
How much of the time?
All the time.
If you were strong all the time, when the devil come against you, well, it just would be like bouncing off a brick wall, right?
Yeah.
And after he bloodied his nose a couple of times, he just wouldn't come around you anymore. Because every time he came around, you're strong. He's looking for you to be weak. But he comes around every time. You're strong because the joy of the Lord is our strength. And because we're walking in that joy and letting the love of God fulfill that joy and keep us in God's joy, his strength, we're more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus, right? See, we're getting into faith now. We're getting into victory now, right? We're getting into prosperity now in every area of our life, because this is what the key to it, the love of God, and letting that love of God flow out and learning to master to how to release the love of God. It's not really that hard, but it does take practice. Love is a decision, not a feeling. We've said that before. But you know, most of us are led by our feelings, not by the spiritual things of God.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And you know, and so everybody's so touchy. Did I hurt your feelings? Oh, I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. And then I had a lady one time tell a bunch of lies on me, and she got sorry about it and repented. And then she calls me up and says, oh, I'm so sorry, I didn't mean to do that. I don't know what happened to me. The devil just got a hold of me. And she says, I guess you just really hate me, don't you? And I said, no. I said, I'm not capable of hate.
Amen.
I'm a new creature in Christ.
Yeah.
My nature is not a nature of hate. It's a nature of love.
That's right.
And forgiveness.
Yeah.
And mercy. And grace. Do you see where we go there? You see how it changes? So I said, no, sister, I don't hate you. I said, it hurt me a little that you did that. But I said, I don't hate you for it. I'm not capable of hatred anymore. Now, before I was saved, hey, I could hate with the best of them. But I can't do that. Even the worst people in my life, which are some of my relatives, the worst people in my life who push every button that's the wrong one, and just in 30 seconds, I'd be around them 30 seconds, and man, I'm already losing it. You know, but I don't hate those people. Now, I would like to see God do some things with those people.
Yes.
Lay hands on them suddenly. A lightning bolt to get their attention. Whatever he wants to do is fine with me. But I don't hate those people. But they are a thorn in my flesh, bless God. So I know a little bit about what Paul's talking about. Hey, I don't need a messenger from Satan. I've got relatives. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Do you understand what I'm talking about?
We know, brother. We know.
Hey, Paul ain't got nothing on me in that department. Hey, I got my own messengers from Satan. Bless God. Don't we all? Don't we all?
Yes, we do.
But love conquers all. Love conquers all. Praise God. Alrighty, let's see. We were in verse 11. These things have I spoken unto you that my joy might remain in you. Thank God. If I can learn to get God's joy in me all the time, oh man, that'll be such a plus.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. And that your joy might be
full.
So he's going to continue to fill up every time you get empty. Every time you start to lose a little joy, he's going to fill it up for you. He's going to fill your tank with fresh oil, with fresh joy. He's going to keep you full of joy. Praise God. If you're full of joy and you're full of the love of God, there ain't too much that's going to bother you. Right? Because if your joy produces feelings, it produces a certain amount of happiness and contentment and peace, does it not? So, but it's not feelings. We don't work our feelings up to get into the Spirit. See, a lot of churches have it wrong. They think, well, we'll work it up and get to God that way. No, you don't work it up from the flesh to the Spirit. It comes from the Spirit to the flesh. And you got to understand that, or you don't understand a lot of things about God. Everything originates in the Spirit realm first before it ever happens in the natural realm. Bless God.
Amen.
Verse 12, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. All right. I want to look at one more scripture before we close tonight. Romans 12. Are you getting anything out of this tonight?
Yeah. All
right. Don't lie to me. I'll know if you lie. Okay? Let's go. I got discerning of spirits. We talked about that a little bit this morning, didn't we? Romans chapter 12. Verse 9. Brother, can we bring that up in the, let's see, where do I want to go? In the Amplified, let's see what it says in the Amplified on verse 9. I don't know about you, but I don't use the word dissemination very much. Do you use that word every day?
No.
I don't go around saying, hey, this thing was just a dissemination. I can't tell you.
I
don't use that. So it says, let love be what?
Sincere.
A real thing. So that's what dissemination means. Without dissemination means it's pure. It's whole.
No,
it's sincere.
No hypocrisy.
Yes. And hate what is evil. So we are to hate in a certain way. It's not like the old way of hating. The better word for hate there is shun, or stay away from anything that's evil. Turn away from anything that's evil. But hold fast to that which is good. And in the King James, I like it better because it says what? And cleave to that which is good. Do you know what cleave means?
Hang on.
It means marrying two things together so that they become one. When you get married, you're to cleave to your wife. And the wife is to cleave to the husband. They become one, right? He's saying here, I want you to cleave to that which is
good.
So if we can just focus, like Brother Ken said this morning in his message you read about the scriptures, anything pure, loving, of a good report, think on these things.
Yeah.
You say, think on the good things. Dwell, keep your mind on the good things of God. Because the devil wants to put the bad things into your mind.
Mm-hmm.
And the Bible says we're to cast those things down. How many times do you cast down a thought, or you just roll it over in your mind? Don't even roll it over one time. When you know it's not God, cast it out.
That's right.
Don't entertain it. Who wants to entertain the devil?
Amen.
You know, don't set a place for him.
No.
You know, throw him out. Right. He's a rascal. He's not got your best interest at heart. Amen. Get rid of him. Get him out of your mind. Say, devil, you're not going to get into my mind. I'm not going to let you work on me today. Bless God. I'm just not going to have it. You've got to learn to cast down those thoughts and imaginations. They try to exalt themselves against the knowledge of God. Praise God. Where are we at? All right, let's read on. Be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love and honor, doing what?
Preferring
one another. When you go to the restaurant, the waitress are, they call them servers now, don't they? Mm-hmm. We're getting politically correct all across the spectrum. I still call them waitresses. But you know, whatever. They'll say, which do you prefer, coffee or tea? Steak or chicken?
Steak.
You or me? Which do you prefer?
Steak.
Well, most of us say, me. I prefer me. Well, that's a dumb question. Of course I prefer me. I'm the most important thing in my life. Bless God. Well, that's not the way the Bible says it, is it?
Come on.
We're to prefer one another over ourselves, right? We're to prefer the other person. If you don't choose coffee, then tea got preferred. You didn't drink coffee that day. If you choose the other person, you have to put yourself on the back burner. You have to say to yourself, I'll get mine later, but right now I'm going to make sure they get theirs. I'm going to prefer them over me. I'm going to make sure they get blessed. I'm going to make sure they get help. And if I need help, God will help me. Or somebody, He'll send somebody to help me. But I'm going to do what the Bible tells me to do. And I'm going to help that other person. That's preferring other people over yourself. And see, that's what the church has missed, because we continue to prefer ourselves over anybody else. Prefer our families over anybody else. And that's not God's way. God's way is you prefer other people over yourself. You reach out to other people in need, who have problems, who have difficulties. And you don't say, when they're on the phone and they're calling you for help, you don't say, oh, that's terrible, but let me tell you what my day's been like. You don't go there. You don't pile up and say, oh, your day's been bad, but my day's been worse.
Mm-hmm.
Are they calling you up to hear how bad a day you had?
No.
They're not, are they?
No.
They're calling you up to get what? Help in their time of need, right? So don't sit there and try to compare who's got the worst day going. You know, no, just say, well, sister, let me pray with you.
Amen.
Or, you know, when they call up and say, tell me again that I'm the healed of God. Because you may have half symptoms in your body. Well, you just start quoting off scriptures. By the stripes of Jesus, you were made whole. He took our infirmities, our sickness, and our disease upon himself on the cross and through the whipping upon his back, that you might walk in wholeness. You are the healed of God. He sent his word and healed you and delivered you. You encourage them. And don't worry about yourself.
Yeah.
You say, but I'm not having a good day myself. Well, bless your little pea-picking arm. You know, God will take care of you. I found if you take care of somebody else, God will take care of you.
Yeah, that's right.
If you try to take care of yourself and disregard the other person, hey, it's a rough road to hoe. If you work the Word will work for you.
It will.
That's a good saying. You need to write that on your refrigerator.
That's good. Amen.
If you work the Word will work for you. Bless God.
Amen, brother.
Praise God.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
The importance of God's love. We covered just a few things tonight. Can you see how important it is?
Yes, sir.
When I was doing this series of lessons, I told God, I said, I'm totally inadequate to do this. You recognize that, right? I said, 50% of what you're talking about, I don't even do. And see, I got so convicted, I started to say condemned, but I got so convicted because I recognize a lot of these things I slip up on myself. I don't do them. And I said, God, won't you give me another message? Something's not so hard on the toes, okay? Bless God. You sure know when to hit a guy when he's down. Bless the Lord. You know, but this is what we need.
Yes, it is.
If we're going to grow up as a body of believers, this is what we need. Because once we get this perfected in the body, then when we turn to the outer world, hey, we've got something to offer that they're going to want.
Yes,
amen.
And when they come into our church, they're going to say, hey, this is different. I've been in other churches, but this atmosphere is different from the other churches I've been in. I sense the love of God and the power of God and the goodness of God and people caring about other people. This church is different. You want your church to be like that.
Amen.
Yes.
You want people to be able to say that about your church.
Amen.
Yes.
It's an oasis of love. See?